Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. We have this morning apologies from Natalie Dawn, MSP. Eleanor Whitman joins us today as a substitute for Natalie. Good morning, Eleanor. The first agenda item is to ask Eleanor Whitman if she has any relevant interests to declare.
Nothing to declare, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item three in private. Item three is consideration of the evidence we will hear this morning. Do we agree to take this item in private? Great, that is agreed. Thank you very much. Our next item today is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into increasing energy prices. This inquiry is looking at the significant increase in energy prices that we've all witnessed in recent months. What is driving this, what impact this is having, and what can be done to alleviate the worst impacts of increasing energy prices. Today we are going to hear from Ofgem. I'm pleased to welcome our panellists, Neil Kenward, Director of Strategy and Decarbonisation, and Neil Lawrence, Director of Retail Office of Gas and Electricity Markets. Good morning, both. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. We've allocated around 75 minutes for this panel session, and I believe, Neil, you would like to start with making a brief opening statement. Is that right?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, I'll hand over to you. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. So, as the energy regulator, our job is to protect the interests of energy consumers, and we know that many consumers in Scotland and across Great Britain are finding the cost of living increases very tough at the moment. I spend a great deal of time with consumer groups, charities and customers, and I'm really aware of the pressure that everybody is under. Wholesale gas prices across Europe and Asia have been extraordinarily volatile and have risen to unprecedented levels over the past year, and that's put the global energy markets under severe pressure. As a consequence in this in Great Britain, we've seen a significant rise in consumer bills, with the price cap increasing by almost £700 in April for approximately 22 million customers, with a further price rise expected this October. Many suppliers simply could not cope with such a sustained price shock, with 28 suppliers exiting the market since last August. Now, throughout the crisis, Ofgem has worked to protect consumer interests. Our safety net has protected more than 4 million customers, making sure that when their supplier has failed, they're kept on supply and their household credit balances are indeed honoured. The price cap has also meant that customers on their supplier's standard variable or their default tariff have been protected against an instant price rise. We need a retail market that is more robust to this volatility in the future. There are therefore two very important changes that we're making to our regulatory framework. Firstly, companies were not resilient enough and financial regulation needs to be significantly enhanced. We're already implementing tougher and tighter financial regulation with greater oversight in the retail market. And secondly, the price cap, although protecting those consumers from those unfair price rises, needs to be more adaptable to rapidly changing market conditions. And we're therefore reforming the price cap to make it more flexible while still retaining the benefits of protection for consumers. In all of this, our priority has been and remains to act in the best interest of energy consumers. And we accept that there are lessons that need to be and have been learned from this crisis. Earlier this year, our board commissioned an independent review into the root causes of the recent supplier failures and specifically into how the regulation of the energy industry played a part. We published this last week. We really accept the recommendations in this report, many of which are already being implemented, and we will ensure that all recommendations are carried out to further strengthen our regulatory regime. Finally, I'd like to end on a more optimistic note. I and my colleagues have spent a great deal of time in the past few months with many retail and consumer groups. It is clear that through closer dialogue and closer working relationships, we're addressing the challenges that customers are currently facing. This closer working relationship between the regulator, retailers and customers is key to build what we need in the long term. A resilient, competitive and dynamic energy retail sector fit to support the transition to net zero. Thank you, convener. We look forward to discussing these important issues with you in the session and answering any questions that you or your colleagues may have.
Thank you very much, Neil, for those opening remarks, which set the scene very well. We'll now move on to Q&A, and I will have a couple of questions before I bring in other colleagues. You mentioned in your opening remarks that Ofgem will introduce new measures to boost financial resilience in the sector, including financial stress testing for all suppliers and increasing the number of times a year that the price cap can be adjusted. A couple of questions on this. What's the timescale for implementing these new measures? And evidence given to this committee by other stakeholders suggests that the price cap will have to be increased between now and the winter season later this year. I wonder if you can talk us through your expectations for the price cap increases we may see over the next 6 to 12 months.
Yeah, thanks very much. So Ofgem absolutely recognises that the price rises that we've seen are having a huge impact on consumers. That's what we really, really care about. And we take our job is to make sure that we pass on a fair price for energy and suppliers are able to charge that fair price to consumers. We don't comment or speculate on future price rises further than saying what I've already said in that we're expecting them to rise. It's driven by wholesale markets in the main. Those are very uncertain and we're in the middle of an observation window. So we won't comment on where those price rises are expected to go in October. As you quite rightly pointed out, we are taking a number of steps to ensure that the market is more financially resilient. We did a lot of work in 2019 to bring in measures around financial resilience, operational capability, fit and proper, all aimed at strengthening the market, and they had a really, really good effect. But we recognise that we need to go further to make the market more resilient. So the measures that we're talking about in financial resilience are around capital adequacy, protecting our own credit balances further, and making sure that we protect customers moving forward. We're bringing in those changes at pace, and we started to on that process last October, and we'd expect to complete that work later this year.
Okay, thanks very much. You mentioned also in your opening remarks that I think around 30 energy companies, suppliers have failed, have had to close shop since early 2021. I think the supplier of last resort process has added £2.8 billion to consumer bills, which is on top of the increasing wholesale costs, and this has affected around 4.3 million domestic customers. Many of the, as you will know, many of the failed energy suppliers didn't hedge their exposure to wholesale prices, and they were taking massive speculative risks that you don't see in other sectors. Do you recognise that the previous regulatory approach taken by Ofgem, which allowed, you know, this market risk, this lack of hedging, now looks to have been inadequate?
So firstly, what we must recognise is we've seen absolutely unprecedented rises in wholesale prices. You know, the prices are 500% more than they were last year. That's truly unprecedented, and this is a global issue. Ofgem had taken a number of steps to make sure that the market was more resilient. We had a range of monitoring regimes throughout COVID to look at supplier finances, to look at the hedging levels that suppliers had. We introduced tougher regimes and tougher measures in early 2021 to try and make sure that we could monitor suppliers and take action where necessary. We've gone further with those proposals with our latest financial resilience measures to make sure that we're fully across suppliers, and where they don't have the right level of capital that they need, then if they choose not to hedge, you know, we will absolutely take action. I think it's really important that you understand we have very robust monitoring regimes in place. So on a weekly level, we receive financial reports from all suppliers in the market, and we review those, and we also receive data on their hedging levels, and we keep a really, really close eye on that. It's important in the context to understand that it's not our job as a regulator to choose the risk management position that a business will take. That's up to them to choose. What we need to do as a regulator is make sure that if they are taking a position, taking some risk, they have the capital adequacy to withstand the shocks. And that's what a lot of the financial regulation changes that we're making will do. This will protect customers in the long run. And rest assured, we don't ever want to see the number of suppliers exiting in a year that we've seen over the past 12 months. We recognise that has had an impact on consumers.
Okay, thank you for that. But if you look at other sectors, the banking sector, if you look at the role of the FCA, they do impose market risk limitations, capital adequacy limitations. I know hindsight's a wonderful thing, but do you think that those capital adequacy and capital risk buffers should have been in place 24 months ago for new suppliers coming into the market?
I think if you look at the number of suppliers that are coming into the market, the numbers dropped dramatically. So we only had two new entrants in 2021, and one of those was a pre-accredited supplier. So the measures that we had in place already were making sure that suppliers that entered the market did in fact have a robust and fit business model to succeed in this market. We have, you know, very robust checks across fit and proper, across the financial projections, across the customer service plans for any new entrant in the market, to ensure that we feel that they are able to operate, they can deliver value to customers, and they can avoid the cost of exit. And where suppliers don't meet those thresholds, we don't let them in, and we have refused license applications over the course of the last 12 months.
And if you look at the cost of the supplier of last resort process, that's added £2.8 billion to consumer bills. What's the average, you know, how's that spread over to the average consumer bill? Do you have a number in terms of what each domestic consumer will have to contribute in their bills towards the cost of that process?
Yeah, so the cost to consumer from the solars to date is £68 per consumer. We recognise that is the cost of the solars. What we must realise is this is absolutely unprecedented. You know, the wholesale price rises we saw from last August, September, October, they were really truly unprecedented, and that was a real struggle for many suppliers. We weren't expecting to see that, and those costs are passed through the solar mechanism. That's the safety net, and we must remember that we do protect consumer balances, and we managed to transfer over 4 million customers to a new supplier so that they didn't lose supply and that they were continue to receive a service for the essential service that they needed. In terms of future costs, you will see that solar cost rise. It doesn't include all of the costs that suppliers will claim through our process. You will see additional costs later this year. And there are, of course, costs for the bulb administration, but those are a matter for government. We're not in control of that.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm sure other members will want to come back to some of these issues, but let me bring in Fiona Hislop for further questioning. Fiona, please.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. We have a cost of living crisis made worse by an energy crisis, but we also have a climate crisis. So I think my questions will be directed to Neil Kenward, because we want to address the tensions between potential tensions between addressing the immediate issues and the transition to net zero, if there are any. So what reforms need to be done, maybe in the longer term, to ensure we've got an energy supply sector which can protect consumer interests, but ensures we can transition to net zero, and what would success look like?
Well, I think this is, you absolutely put your finger on the really important long-term picture, which is to get this transition to net zero and make sure it happens smoothly and in the interest of consumers and keep the costs down for that transition. And we were seeing, even before this big surge in gas prices, we were seeing that some forms of renewable power, for example, were cheaper than gas-generated electricity. So we were already seeing that structural move to a point where decarbonisation can actually reduce costs for consumers. And, of course, with gas prices the way they are now, the low-carbon transition is not in conflict with a lower-cost system. Actually, going faster on that transition will help bring down costs for consumers faster. So that's something that Ofgem stands ready to support. And we, through our regulatory regimes, we help ensure that the infrastructure gets built to help that low-carbon transition occur, and that it gets built at a low cost to consumers through things like our regulated asset base regime and network regulations. And one thing I'd observe is that the cost of, if you put all the environmental schemes and subsidies together, the total cost of that, it's not insignificant, but it's about just over £130 in the current price cap period per consumer on an annualised basis. And that's actually less than it was in the previous price cap period. And that's because a number of increasingly the renewable generation is on fixed price contracts. And so when the price in the market is high, driven by the gas price, those contracts actually pay back to consumers. So we're actually getting a situation now where the costs of decarbonisation is helping bring down the cost of bills for consumers.
So in Scotland, you know that we have an extensive range of renewable assets and generation, but we export much of our renewable electricity, but your regime is tailored to the United Kingdom market as a whole. And clearly there are inhibitors in Scotland for that expansion to net zero energy production, not least the exorbitant transmission costs. And there's a danger that even under the new regimes that might be coming, the subsidy goes to the consumer, where the consumer base is, rather than the generation of energy. So what can be done to ensure that Scotland can contribute to net zero by powering ahead with renewables? And what might have to happen in a UK market regime to enable that to happen? And what changes would you see, not least in transition charges?
So the commitment that we make is to try and get this net zero transition happening at least cost to consumers. And we try and establish the rules and the incentives to ensure that there is a low-cost system overall. And the transmission charges are set up in that way. So they're meant to incentivise new generation in the locations closest to the main centres of demand. So that's why these transmission charges vary in different parts of the country. Now, of course, there are ways in which we are helping facilitate new infrastructure investment to enable the growing level of renewable and obviously the potential for more renewable power in Scotland is vast. And so the system operator, the grid, is developing new network plans, and those strategic plans will help facilitate more transmission capacity to get that low carbon power from Scotland down to England when there's a surplus north of the border. And I think that sort of that long-term structure is really important to make sure that increased capacity is built, and then you get an efficient system across GB.
But do you acknowledge that those grid plans still penalise Scotland, and that we have people living in fuel poverty in the part of the United Kingdom that generates the most energy in terms of renewable energy, but also in terms of oil and gas? Is that not something that, you know, is wrong?
So fuel poverty, of course, is a problem across GB, As my colleague has been saying, what we try and do is establish a least cost system, but we don't have the ability to introduce new subsidies. So for us, it's about the fair prices across the whole of GB.
Any subsidy issues would be addressed by a UK government in an energy market to deliver what you wanted?
That's right.
OK. Bear in mind the recent price energy spikes. Is there a case for wholescale energy market reform? You've already referred to gas being the marginal generation technology setting the price. So what options are there? What major changes, wholesale major changes, are needed? And obviously you'd need the UK to give you instructions as regulators as to what that would be. What would you like it to be, and what do you anticipate it to be? And bearing in mind the immediate issues that we are facing, do you see any steps being taken in the Queen's speech today to enable that to happen?
So I think we fully accept that we and the governments need to look at the current energy market and ensure that it is reformed in order to be fit for the net zero future. It will be a very different energy system. So as you'd be fully aware, the growing dominance of renewables on the system changes the nature of the electricity market quite considerably. There'll be this probably surpluses of low carbon power when the wind is blowing and the sun is shining. But then we'll have to use other sources, obviously, when that isn't the case. And so I think it is absolutely right that the government looks at, the Westminster government, looks at how that market operates and considers whether reforms are necessary to ensure an efficient system going forwards. And I think they announced as part of the energy security strategy a few weeks ago that they were undertaking a review of the energy markets and would publish some documents on that in the coming months. And obviously in Ofgem, we are really keen to work with the Westminster government on that and make sure that the interests of consumers are being fully protected in that consideration.
And just finally for me, Convener, how long will that take? We know that we're facing an energy price crisis now for people. Some of the changes will need wholesale energy market reform. So what would be the desirable time frame to get that wholesale energy market reform to start to make an impact?
Yeah, and I think the reality is, as I'm sure you'll appreciate, that making changes, major changes, if that's what the Westminster government chooses to do, to wholesale markets, is a process that's likely to take years. And so I think it's important that, that Ofgem and indeed the sector and indeed governments in Westminster, Holyrood and elsewhere are taking what steps they can to support consumers in the short run, because the high prices that we see this year, and as Mr. Lawrence says, probably higher still in the autumn, those can't be addressed by long-term reforms such as wholesale market reform.
Sorry, can I just say that, you know, there doesn't seem a sense of urgency. During the COVID pandemic, we saw the whole system changes because of a world emergency. I don't get a sense that, you know, if this is wait and see, it might take some years. What are you as a regulator trying to do to increase the pace, the scale and the impact of these changes and reforms?
We are taking steps to make sure that the system works effectively. We're moving ahead we're supporting the creation of the new system operator to make sure that it can do this strategic planning and we can make the changes that are needed. And we're looking at how markets function to make sure that they are as efficient as they can be. So we are absolutely moving at pace, but some of those major changes inevitably, I'm afraid, take time, particularly if they require legislation.
Thank you, Convener.
OK, Fiona, thanks very much. I believe that Liam Kerr has a supplemental in this area. Liam, over to you.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just on the point about transmission charges, obviously the Deputy Convener talks about the transmission charges being higher to generators in Scotland, but isn't it the case, or can you help the committee understand, isn't it the case that that simply reflects the reality that demand is concentrated elsewhere, further away from where it's generated, and therefore demand customers are paying the overwhelming majority of to Nuos, and therefore actually consumers in Scotland are paying a cheaper rate for their electricity than they otherwise would be were there the market reforms that the Deputy Convener outlines?
So I'm not sort of going to speculate about different potential reforms, but the transmission network charges are set up to try and incentivise the most efficient location of generation. And as you rightly say, the greater demand is where the greater population is, which is in the south. And so there's obviously enormous low-carbon assets in Scotland. And as I say, getting more infrastructure built to get that low-carbon power down to England when it's demanded is absolutely fundamental to the network plans that are being developed by the system operator. And from our perspective, we'll be trying to make sure that the regulatory process is able to accelerate those investments, and those investments can come forward at least cost.
Thank you.
Great, thanks, Liam. Next up, Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. If I can start following on from what the Deputy Convener was speaking about the cost of living crisis. I'd be interested in your thoughts on how that should be tackled in the short to medium term without compromising the strategic emissions reduction goals. Mr. Kenward, I'll start with you, maybe. Or am I better with Mr. Lawrence? Yeah,
well, we can probably both chip in on this one. It's useful to point out some of the statistics. As I mentioned, the total of the environmental schemes and programmes, the total cost of those has fallen from about £145 per household on an annualised basis down to just over £130. The cost of the wholesale market component has doubled in the same period of time from 500 and something to now over £1,000. So it's really clear where the key cost drivers are coming from in this market. So what we're doing is what we require, so in terms of affordability, as Ms. Lawrence says, it's not something that we as a regulator can tackle the affordability challenge. That has to be tackled by governments. But we are requiring suppliers to take the actions they can take to make sure that consumers who are struggling to pay their bills get financial advice and that perhaps get emergency credit, and individual suppliers have their own support schemes available to consumers in need. But none of that will be sufficient to deal with the price rises that are coming.
Maybe if I can just add a couple of words to that. We support the UK government's £200 rebate scheme for households. That will make a difference this year. We'll work hard to make sure that that's implemented alongside the limited role that we've got. From a compliance perspective, we announced a series of market-wide compliance reviews to make sure that suppliers are absolutely looking after customers in the right way, so they have the right customer service standards, they have the right processes in place around vulnerability and affordability. And we'll take that role very, very seriously. And where we find that suppliers don't come up to scratch, aren't setting the standards that we expect in the industry, we will absolutely take action. Suppliers do have a range of schemes available. Our advice to all consumers, if they are struggling with the high bills, is to contact the energy supplier in the first instance. There are things like Fuel Direct, winter fuel payments available, warm home discount, cold weather payments. And as Neil said, there are a range of other things that suppliers will try to do to help. What we have to recognise is this is absolutely unprecedented times. And there are a lot of people asking for that support right now, and the numbers will increase as we go through to next winter. Our role as regulator is to make sure that the suppliers are set up and are resilient enough to cope with that increased demand and can service customers, because this is an essential service. You know, this really is serious stuff.
Do you think that will be enough not to make a huge impact on the reduction goals that have been put in place? You know, the measures that you've outlined? Or do you think that to try and balance it out, one may have to suffer rather than the other?
Can I clarify? Are you talking about the potential tension between the decarbonisation goals and the...
Yeah, we've got the strategic emissions reduction goals.
Yeah.
And so are they going to be met with what is being put in place?
So I think... we have got, in the UK and in Scotland, extremely ambitious decarbonisation goals, and it's Ofgem's job to facilitate those and to help deliver those at least cost to consumers. And we do that in a number of ways. So, in a sense, as I was saying earlier, I don't think there is a tension between that short term and the long run. There is a short term problem for all energy consumers in the UK and indeed across Europe, but that shouldn't stop us from moving ahead at pace with the decarbonisation agenda, because we think that is ultimately the best way to bring down costs for everyone and to get a low carbon, low cost and a secure energy system.
Okay, thank you. And also the convener was mentioning earlier about the added £2.8 billion to consumer bills on top of the increase in the wholesale costs. Do you think this is the best way to recover the costs? And was any other options being considered, or do you think they should have been considered?
So the cost of the solar impact is £68 per customer, £1.8 billion, and there are costs on top for Bulb. We have a set process in place for our solar process to protect consumers that enables us to move the consumers across to a new supplier and enables the cost of that transition to be charged through what is into the solar levy mechanism. That's the process that we used. It's tested to stress with 28 suppliers going out of the market, and we're really, really pleased that we managed to move those 4 million customers, protect them, ensure they were kept on supply and ensure the credit balances were protected.
And we, in a sense, we don't have options to change the way that was recovered. That's the way the solar system is set up. And so it does require being recovered from consumers over a period of time. I'm afraid it's only the governments rather than ourselves that would be able to change the way that's recovered.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jackie. Next up, Monica Lennon. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to you both. Thank you for joining us. Listening this morning, I've heard both of you mention fair prices a couple of times, I think, particularly Neil Lawrence. Many people across the country will be wondering, what is a fair price? What's happening right now doesn't feel fair. So maybe you can tell me from an Ofgem perspective what fair pricing means and looks like to you.
Look, I absolutely recognise that the consumers up and down the country are struggling with the price of bills and the wider affordability crisis that we're seeing in the country. This is unprecedented and is driven by the energy increases are driven by those high wholesale prices that we've talked about. If we just take a step back and look what our role as regulator is, it is to ensure that the suppliers charge a fair price for the energy to consumers, and that means they have to pass on those costs of supply. So if the wholesale price increases, then they have to be able to pass that on. Energy in the UK is not subsidised at the retail level, so there's no subsidisation for those consumers. So therefore, we have to allow the suppliers to pass on those fair costs. Otherwise, those business models wouldn't be sustainable. Those suppliers would go out of business, and ultimately that would lead to a bigger cost for consumers in terms of supplier exit, so maybe further SARs or maybe further solars. So that's what the mechanism does under the price cap. Those costs are absolutely challenged. So in the price cap methodology, we look through at suppliers' costs. You know, we robustly challenge and look for evidence. So we set it at a fair level. But any decision around cost subsidy to the consumer, so price subsidy to consumer, that is a matter for government and not something that is within our gift.
And it's worth noting that the price cap has had its desired effect, which was to prevent the, if you like, price exploitation of consumers who weren't active in the market, and they were sometimes being charged considerably more than the cost of delivering their energy, and the price cap has been set at a very tight level, so tight, in fact, that suppliers collectively were making losses because we were trying to drive efficiency through the system. So that has been successful in terms of preventing exploitation of inactive consumers. And it's also smoothed, yes, of course, we're seeing a record rise in prices, but it's actually smoothed the impact of the rises in gas prices that we've seen in the last few months.
Just a further build, if I may, you know, over the last 2 to 3 years, suppliers have not made any money in this market from a retail perspective. So it's been a very, very tough time for suppliers. So we have removed that loyalty penalty, but we must recognise the costs and the pain that suppliers are feeling at the moment, and that's coming through in our data. What we need to do is we need to create a market that is investable. We need to create a market that is fair and that will enable that transition to net zero.
Some of my colleagues in a previous session did touch on some of the very healthy profits made by the Big Six, albeit perhaps not from the current retail market, but they're not exactly in fuel poverty themselves. Neil Lawrence, you also talked about the importance of regulator, retailers and consumers working together. I think to perhaps try and foster some trust there. I'm looking at a news article yesterday reporting on some comments by Martin Lewis, known through his work as money saving expert. And I think it's fair to say Martin Lewis is trusted by the public, more so than people trust politicians or energy companies. But he says yesterday that an energy bill surge smells wrong as direct debits increase by 100%. So people have always been encouraged to pay for energy by direct debit. So they're saying here that after energy prices took a 54% price hike in April, some users of his website complained their bills went up by 100%. Does that seem right and fair to you? What's the explanation behind that?
Yeah, so look, I absolutely recognise that in the current context, current affordability crisis that we've seen, this is troubling times for consumers and people are struggling to pay their bills. We absolutely understand that and we empathise with it. We were aware of a number of reports of direct debit increases, and earlier this year we announced a series of market compliance reviews, the first of which was direct debit, to review how suppliers are set up and how they increase direct debits. Are they fair? That is a very, very invasive review. So we're collecting a range of data, but we're also looking at the management control frameworks that are in place at suppliers to assess that they really, really do take this seriously. Martin has conducted some independent analysis, and we absolutely welcome that. That's very, very helpful, and he has agreed to share the information and data with us. Direct debits can increase for a range of reasons. So we've seen a drift to SVT from contracts, which may have increased direct debits. We have to recognise some of that data. But rest assured, where I find and where my colleagues find that suppliers have not treated customers fairly, we will take robust enforcement action over that, because customers need to receive a fair price for their energy charged for by their supplier. So we will take this very seriously. We are on it, and I'm looking forward to getting the results back from our compliance work.
Thank you. We also heard from Citizens Advice Scotland and others that they're really struggling to keep up with demand for advice. I just wanted to draw to your attention one of the comments we heard. It was from Energy Action Scotland. It was from Fraser Scott when he came to the committee, and he warned that the energy price rises could lead to the catastrophic loss of life this winter if the UK Government and Scottish Government don't take further action. Again, from an Ofgem point of view, in the short term and perhaps in the medium to long term, what further action do you think needs to be taken, both by yourselves as regulator, by the companies and by governments? And is there anything that local authorities could be doing as they pull together their administrations after election time to try and help people at a community level?
Yeah. So, look, I absolutely recognise the comments that have been made and are aware of them. Our job is to protect consumers, but ultimately the matters of affordability and cost of living are for government. We have a very limited set of tools in play within Ofgem that we have at our disposal. We do take the redress fund fines that we have, and we have redistributed as fuel vouchers for a number of consumer and charity groups in the past, and we'll continue to do that this winter to help those most in need. There are a number of schemes that I've outlined already today in terms of water, warm home discount, etc., that are available. Our advice is, if you are struggling with your bill, to go and contact your energy supplier in the first instance, who will provide you with the help and support that you need. But I absolutely do recognise those comments.
Okay, and longer term, Neil Kinward, anything you want to add?
From our perspective, there are a number of measures we will be taking. So, for example, as we move to that more renewables-dominated system, there will be a premium on flexibility. So if we can put the frameworks, the markets and the incentives in place for people to flex their demand for electricity so that it more closely matches when it's windy and when it isn't, then that level of flexibility could reduce costs on the system by up to £10 billion a year. That's a long-run figure. But that's the sort of savings we think we can help deliver through our regulation of the sector.
Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Neil Kenward, in opening remarks, Neil Lawrence said that wholesale gas prices are volatile, and then went on to say, as a consequence, there's been a rise in consumer bills. Now, the UK government's energy security strategy will launch a further oil and gas offshore licensing round with the view that would improve energy security and affordability. So the question I ask you is, what could be the impact on prices for domestic and commercial customers if the gas that we need is being sourced locally rather than imported?
So, first thing to say is that Ofgem doesn't really have a remit for oil and gas production, the upstream industry, and we're not really experts in this sector. The only thing I would say is that prices in these markets, particularly gas markets, are set at a European or global level. So you can read from that how much contribution sort of increased production at a UK continental shelf level might have. But for us, this is all part of a broader transition to net zero, which for us is I think the best way to bring down costs in the long run.
Sticking on that point about net zero, because I think the Deputy Convener and Jackie Dunbar asked pertinent questions earlier, which I'd just like to explore. Some people are understandably very worried that an energy price crisis could undermine our drive to net zero. Whilst others suggest that by increasing the use of domestic gas, which an earlier panel heard has about half to a third of the carbon footprint of imported gas, perhaps more reliance on nuclear generation and the current focus by both Scotland's governments on things like heating buildings, that actually the transition could be accelerated. So the question for you, Neil Kenward, is what is your view and how do we as a committee, as a parliament, ensure that the transition continues whilst balancing the cost to consumers?
So I think for the critical thing here is to keep an eye on that long-term transition. And yes, we need to focus on the short-term, make sure, as my colleague is doing with his teams, that the market is stable and that we're protecting consumers in the short run, but not lose sight of that transition to deliver a lower cost, low carbon system in the long run. And I think there's a number of ways in which Ofgem can help do that. We are, for example, likely to be asked to set up a new system of economic regulation for new nuclear power and for carbon capture and storage. And we can use our regulatory tools to facilitate the billions of pounds of investment that will be needed in these low carbon technologies and to make sure that investment happens at the lowest possible cost to consumers. We're also supporting the development of other new technologies like hydrogen and clean hydrogen, and which may have quite an important role in the future, yet to be determined what that role is. But we're helping through our innovation funds, for example, to test how hydrogen might work in, say, a domestic heating environment and to see whether that is a viable and low-cost form of energy for the future. So I think that's the sort of steps that we as a regulator can take. I'm not able to comment on the sort of the oil and gas exploration market and the impacts of that on the oil and gas prices, because that's outside of our remit. But for us, it is that transition and Ofgem's ability to help the transition and keep it at the lowest cost for consumers that is what we're focused on.
Neil Lawrence, do you have anything to add to that? Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much. Liam, next up is Mark Ruskell. I'll hand over to you, Mark, please.
Thanks. Really interesting evidence that you presented this morning. And I wanted to go back to the theme that Monica Lennon was exploring around just how this is impacting on individual households. I mean, it's quite clear that for some people, for some households, this is devastating. And it will continue to be devastating. And you're saying you can't really predict where the prices for energy are going to be in October, let alone, you know, in October 2023. So I'm really concerned about those people that may end up in spiralling levels of debt. I wanted to ask you about the specific proposal that Scottish Power, Keith Anderson, has made around setting up a deficit fund that could really help people who are in those very deep forms of debt when it comes to their energy bills, £1,000 that can be effectively given to people to get them out of fuel poverty, or at least to stop them slipping even deeper into fuel poverty, paid back by presumably all consumers over 10 years. What's your analysis of that as a specific proposal? How does that compare to what the UK government has already announced?
So look, we absolutely recognise, and I've said it time and time again, I'll keep repeating, but this is an incredibly tough time for consumers, and I truly appreciate that those most needy in our society are finding today's conditions incredibly, incredibly tough. We have openly supported the UK's announcement for a £200 rebate on our household energy bills this winter, and we're working actively to support that. That is a government policy, but all these decisions around affordability, so other measures such as the one that Keith has talked about and discussed widely yesterday, they are a matter and a decision for government. They're not within our gift, so it's a decision and question for them.
But as regulators, you've got a duty to protect the short-term and the long-term interest of energy consumers. So are you saying that you have no role in terms of modelling or working out what the impact of a policy like that would be in terms of advising government or...
So absolutely, we collect a range of data from charity groups, from our own commission, our own independent analysis to look at the impact of those things. I don't have that information with me today, so I can't comment on the impact of Keith's proposal from yesterday. But as I said, our role is not to decide on these things. So we can analyse the impact of them. We can see what it could do for a consumer, but it's not our role to make those decisions. That's not within our gift.
Yeah, I'm not really asking you to make a decision. That is the role of politicians, obviously. But I'm asking, in your role as regulator, surely you're able to look at everything that's in the toolbox. Now, you know, Scottish Power made this suggestion several weeks ago. Keith Anderson was in this committee several weeks ago. I think he made the suggestion of this deficit fund at Westminster, I think, a month ago now. So why is it that you're not looking at that right now? Why is it that you've come to this committee today without a clear view on what the impact would be on consumers of that idea? And what else is in the toolbox? What other options might there be that you're actively looking at, not with a sort of, we think you should do this, Minister, but very much, look, this would be the impact if you went down this route or that route, as advice to government, or at least data to government and parliamentary committees?
Yeah, so we work absolutely very closely with government on a range of issues in the market, and we're able to provide our information and data on affordability issues, and on how tough it is for consumers. I speak to consumers all the time personally. I speak to a range of charity and consumer groups to try and get get the data and get the information that we need as regulators, so we can provide views. But the decisions and the drive around any affordability measures, any social policy, is not for Ofgem, it is for government. So I don't have the information that you're asking for. I can look and take that away. But these decisions and the drive of social policy is a government decision. It's not ours.
Well, I think if you had some form of independent analysis of that specific proposal and how it measures up against what the government is currently proposing, pros and cons, I think that would be very useful for this committee. I'm going to ask you another question. And I hope this doesn't again fall into another area where it's like, well, it's not nothing to do with us, but fuel oil, LPG, massive issue, particularly in Scotland, particularly for off-gas communities, who are seeing an enormous volatility and price spikes. I mean, to be honest, they have been for years, but particularly at the moment in the cost of fuel oil, and it really is driving, again, rural fuel poverty, often in homes which are very hard to heat, very hard to retrofit. What's your thinking, if I can tempt you to say something on this, about regulation of oil and LPG going forward, where that needs to be brought into the regulatory framework, what the options might be there?
Yeah, and I'm afraid it's not an area that we have regulatory responsibility for. We don't have the ability to regulate that. We do absolutely recognise and understand that there are millions of homes off the gas grid who are use other forms of fuel for their heating, and sometimes those can be expensive and subject to considerable volatility. So we see that happening in the market, but we don't have the remit to regulate it. Now, if governments asked us to do that and gave us those powers, we of course could do that. And for example, in heat networks, that's an area where historically we haven't had a regulatory role, but it looks like we will be given a remit to oversee heat networks. I believe the Scottish Government and Westminster Government want us to take that role on. So that's something that, an example of where Ofgem can take on additional responsibilities if we're asked to by governments.
Yeah. And in terms of those rural off-gas homes then, I mean, do you think part of the issue here is that in 10 years' time we'll have completely transitioned away from oil and LPG heating in rural areas, and we'll have other options, be it, you know, biomass, be it air source, high temperature air source heat pumps or whatever? Yeah. Or is this going to be sticky? Are we still going to have homes 10 years time that are being heated by heating oil, and therefore we're still going to have to regulate?
My understanding is that the intent is to actually prioritise the off gas grid homes for decarbonising heating. Certainly that's what the Westminster government talks about. partly because the costs are often higher for those homes, and they may not all be suitable for heat pumps because you need certain levels of insulation, for example. But I think it is important that where heat pumps are viable, that's a sector that is supported to move away from the higher costs and high carbon forms of heating that some of them currently use.
Okay, thanks.
Great, Mark. Thank you very much. Next up is Elena Whittam. Elena, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to both of you. I'm also the convener of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, and we've been taking a huge amount of evidence recently with regards to debt and poverty. And as you can imagine, this is an area that we're acutely focused on. Several times this morning, you've mentioned, Mr. Lawrence, that this is unprecedented. To people at the sharp end that we're taking evidence from, this feels like a return to the days of where if you couldn't afford a bag of coal, you had no heating and no means to cook some food. So I want to look at some data following on from my colleague Mark Ruskell as well. If we think about the winter that we've just come through, so winter 21-22, for consumers in Scotland, you know, how difficult was this an increase to cope with? Have we seen more self-disconnections? We knew that there was self-disconnections already. You know, in my own local authority area, a couple of years ago, we had uncovered about 300 people self-disconnected. And do we think that that's something that's going to only increase as we go forward?
Yeah, thanks for that question. So, look, I absolutely recognise the issues you talked about. As I said, I spend a lot of time with consumer groups understanding those issues firsthand, and I truly empathise with them. This is an absolutely extraordinary time. It's very, very difficult. We are absolutely aware there's probably 613,000 households that are in fuel poverty in Scotland, and the numbers that we have are 311,000 households in extreme fuel poverty. So we absolutely recognise the size and the scale of the challenge that those individuals are facing. We're aware of self-disconnection. It occurs in the market, so customers will choose not to heat their home, to switch off all of their appliances, disconnect their prepayment meter as a way of reducing cost. We do require that suppliers absolutely do look out for that, and they do monitor it as part of our regulation. Earlier this year, we announced a series of reviews, the market compliance reviews, to get under the skin of what it is that suppliers do to protect consumers. That includes vulnerability and affordability, so looking at how they treat those consumers, the steps that they take to make sure that they protect those consumers, particularly those that are most vulnerable in our society. Again, that's a very, very stringent, it's a very, very invasive measure. So we'll be looking at a range of data, but more importantly, looking at the overall control framework that people have in place to make sure that they protect those consumers and get into areas such as self-disconnection. It's a tough time out there, and we absolutely do recognise that. Our role is to try and support consumers. If we find that suppliers are not up to scratch, so they're not scaling their operations, they're not ready for what will be increased call volumes later this year as a result of vulnerability and affordability concerns, we will take action. We have a number of things that we can do, such as banning them taking on new customers or taking action under the operational responsibility principle. So we will do that to try and protect consumers in the best way. But we recognise that this is unprecedented times. This is not what we would have expected from the UK energy market, given those high wholesale prices, and that is a global issue.
Okay, so in terms of those measures, are you saying that the measures are going to be increased, the sanctions that are going to be applied to companies who don't actually actively look out for these individuals and start to offer some type of supports? Because in the past, people have been self-disconnected for years without any support being offered. So are you assuring this committee today and myself as the convener of another committee that action is going to be forthcoming?
So through the market compliance reviews in this area, we'll have that information, we'll have that data, we'll understand which suppliers are treating customers fairly and which ones aren't, and where we find that they are not adhering to the rules, we will take action to protect consumers. And we absolutely understand that this is a key moment this year, this is a key set of work that we're doing, And we have to ensure that the consumers are protected. This is an absolutely vital service, and we've heard from other colleagues around the table today about the impact that could have and comments in the press. So I take that role really, really seriously. We will work at pace with regard to those reviews. And, you know, where we see the suppliers are not acting in the best interest of consumers, we will take action to protect them. It would be, one of the other things, just to add, if I may, this is an area where, you know, potentially extra legislation could help us. You know, I don't have the stepping powers that I would like. If I saw a supplier, you know, not acting in the best interest of consumers, I saw severe detriment, I don't have the ability to step in to that organisation and take over and do the right thing. And that's one of the areas that we would like to see changed in legislation that would make us more effective as a regulator.
Okay, thank you for that. I have one further question. As is usually the case, there's not enough disaggregated gendered data, but there's strong circumstantial evidence that women are at higher risk of experiencing circumstances known to make households more vulnerable to fuel poverty. I'm thinking about lower incomes, I'm thinking about heading single-parent families and having a carer status. Therefore, it's important that policymakers understand what role gender may play so that they can respond accordingly. So can I ask you, what gendered analysis Ofgem as a regulator employed prior to lifting the price cap, and how do you intend to monitor its impact on women going forward?
So I'm sorry to say I don't have that data with me today. I'd have to go back to base and write to you afterwards. I don't have the information and statistics of that nature. What we'd say is we're here to protect all consumers, and I absolutely recognise the challenges across households, particularly those of single parent families. And the impact that can have. There are stringent rules in place for protection of customers, and we've seen a very, very low number of disconnections, and there are a range of measures in place to protect those consumers, but I regret to say I don't have that information that you're asking for, and I can't answer that exact question today.
I think that highlights the fact that we don't always have that information, and you know, it's information that we need everybody to start pulling together.
We have tried to improve the sophistication of our distributional analysis and introduced a more sophisticated way in which we are understanding different consumer groups, including low-income groups. So we do have a stronger framework now to look at those impacts.
Thank you very much, Eleanor. Just a couple of questions. I think there are a couple of supplementals to follow up in this line of questioning. Going back to the 29 energy companies that have failed over the last 18 months, in some cases because of financial mismanagement, a lack of hedging, which was designed to maximise their profits, has Ofgem taken any action against those companies or the directors involved? Do you have the powers to do so, or have you referred those companies to other regulators who may have the powers to take further action?
So I absolutely recognise the issue. As I said before, we have robust monitoring regimes in place. Those monitoring regimes have been through in continuous improvement since the COVID crisis to monitor the financial resilience of suppliers, get under the skin of the business models, understand what hedging levels they take. On a weekly basis, I get reports on the hedging levels across the market and on the financial viability of suppliers. And we have the ability to step in and do audits. We've done a number of audits in the past year to really, really understand the financial health of suppliers. That's all about acting in the best interest of consumers and protecting consumers moving forward. We're going further with our financial responsibility measures, so there's more robust steps in place, and we will absolutely take action. With regard to the action against directors, I can't comment on the specific cases in a public forum, but we have worked very, very extensively with the Insolvency Service on a number of cases and have made reports, but I can't comment on those today. I'd be grateful if you don't push me any further on that.
No, I totally understand that. I appreciate the response. Jackie Bailey wanted to follow up on a question. Wanted to follow up on a question as well. Apologies, Jackie.
Thank you. You said earlier that consumers choose to self-disconnect. I'm afraid I'd have to disagree with you. There is no choice when they get to that stage. And And if I can touch maybe on the prepayment meter households, they are most vulnerable normally, and yet they are paying more than the direct debit households, and they're paying a premium for the energy. I think we've touched on it before in other committee panels. You know, where there's little to protect our most vulnerable in regards to the prepayment households. Can you tell me if there is protection methods in there and what more should be done to protect what, quite frankly, is our most vulnerable, because they're the ones that are paying the highest tariff?
Yeah, so first of all, to be clear, we absolutely recognise the difference in tariff prices between prepayment and current credit customers, and absolutely right, there is a difference, and prepayment customers do pay more. If we go back to the context and the wider context of that, we have to allow suppliers to charge a fair price for their energy, and the costs of supplying prepayment meters are indeed higher than credit meters, and there are higher operational costs. And if we didn't let the suppliers pass through that cost to those consumers, then ultimately they wouldn't have a sustainable business model. We accept there's a difference. The transition to smart prepay will reduce the cost, and we'd be absolutely focused on making sure that we can see that happen across the prepayment community, and that will make them cheaper in the long run. Absolutely understand that it's a difficult time, and some of the most vulnerable customers are indeed on prepayment. We have a range of measures in place to try and protect those vulnerable customers. And as I said earlier, we are actively assessing suppliers' ability to meet those obligations through the market compliance reviews that we're doing. And those market compliance reviews do cut across credit and prepay. It's all customers. And as I said earlier, you know, we absolutely will take action if we find that suppliers are not supporting those customers that are vulnerable. That they aren't doing what they need to and aren't meeting their obligations, and we will take very, very firm action. We absolutely recognise that if suppliers don't provide that support this winter, that could have a very, very catastrophic impact for those customers.
And I could add that I believe last week we fined one energy network company for insufficient support for some of the vulnerable customers on their network, and we fined them £15 million, which is obviously a significant sum.
If I could just come back, Convener. I mean, we hear as well that these prepayment meters are left in houses when people move out, so that when the new tenants go in, they're automatically put onto the higher tariff. We've heard that it's up to them and not maybe the landlords or the suppliers themselves to get the meter taken out. Which maybe I would say we put some folk, they can't afford to take out the meter, so that they're left with paying the higher payments. Is there anything that can be done in roundabout that regards? I'm not sure if you'd be able to answer that, but it'd be interesting to hear.
So certainly our advice to customers is, if they move into a property with a prepayment meter and they want to move on to a credit, is to contact the energy supplier and have that discussion, and the energy supplier is obligated to work with them. If customers are in a debt situation, we are aware that at times prepayment meters can be a source of moving that customer out of debt, and customers do often choose to be on prepayment meters. It's not a case of suppliers absolutely enforce the installation of the prepayment meters. A lot of customers do choose that option for budgeting purposes, and we have to just be aware of those facts. But my advice is, you know, contact your energy supplier if you're in that case. If you have a constituent that's spoke to you about that, you know, do pass on that advice. Talk to your energy supplier, see what they can do.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Jackie. With a few further supplementals in this area, Monica Lennon to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Monica, please.
Thank you, Convener. It's just to follow on from Eleanor Whittam's important question on gender disaggregated data and your offer to write to the committee. Just from my own understanding, does that mean that you're confirming to this committee that Ofgem does hold that data How recent is it, and has analysis been done of that data? So you don't have to write to us and say we don't have the data, so just to get some clarification.
Yeah, sorry if I wasn't clear. Apologies for that. So I'd have to check what data we've got available on it. As I said, I don't have that information in front of me now. I have to go back to base, and that's why we said we would write to you afterwards. So I can't answer the question right now, and apologies for that.
Okay, that's fine. That's what I thought. It seems like you were a bit uncertain, but thank you for that.
Mark, please.
You made a comment earlier on about smart meters, I think, and about the ability of consumers to move on to variable tariffs. But you know, where are we with smart meter rollout? I mean, is this something that could be significantly ramped up between now and October, between October and when the next price cap potentially comes up? And how significant could that be? Are we talking about large numbers that could be on smart meters and have that ability to move on to variable tariff? Or are we still looking at relatively low numbers of consumers who found out this is even a possibility, let alone had an installation?
Yeah, so we've recently agreed a set of targets with the industry with regard to smart meter rollout. So all suppliers have an obligated target that they need to meet for this year. We monitor that on a regular basis. So we look at the number of installations that are completed, the numbers that are forecasted, and how they progress on those targets. Those are hard-baked targets where, again, suppliers don't meet those. There are penalties that we can apply, and we will do, as we take that matter really, really, really seriously. And we have an ongoing set of people that are responsible for looking at that within Ofgem. The capacity in the system is the capacity in the system, and so suppliers aren't planning to, you know, roll out 100% of smart meters this summer. They have obligated targets to progress, and that's what's been agreed.
I mean, is there an argument to say, though, that that should be revisited, and if there are supply chain issues, then, you know, scaling up that more rapidly in the next 12 months would, and perhaps even targeting it at those consumers that are most affected by the price increases might be a way forward?
So I absolutely recognise, I think, that we would like to see smart meters rolled out across the country and see the benefits that they can have for reducing energy consumption. That's what we're focused on. At the moment, there are no plans to delve deeper into the smart meter rollout that's happening within each supplier and target and target where they are with specific vulnerable cases.
Thanks very much, Mark. Final set of questions from Fiona Hislop. Fiona, please.
Thank you. If I'm understanding you correctly, you're saying that support for individuals and subsidy is a responsibility of government, that you have limited interventions in the immediate area, but you can fine people, or direct companies, you can intervene if you think they're not providing sufficient support for individuals, but you would welcome legislation to give you more powers in that area. Can you be a bit more specific about what would be useful legislation? And reflecting the discussion we've just had about prepayment meters, is there a law or should there be legislation to require energy suppliers to replace prepayment meters if there is a request from an individual to do so? And that's to Neil Lawrence, I think.
Yeah, so what I was referring to earlier was if I see a supplier that's not acting in the best interest of consumers, I'm seeing severe consumer detriment, I don't currently have an option to step in to that supplier, take over that supplier, and mend those issues. And those step-in powers, additional powers that may protect customers, and that's what we would like to see. That's what would be really, really helpful. Through our monitoring activity, you know, we absolutely can see the performance of suppliers around a range of consumer customer service metrics, range of affordability issues. You know, we talked about the additional work we're doing in the market compliance reviews. And we can use our existing powers, yes, but those step-in rights would really be an ultimate sanction and would enable us to move quicker. And it's that pace of change that's the important thing. So when you see things going awry or you're aware that a supplier is in trouble, having that ability to step in. Other powers that we've talked about are being able to intervene during the process when a company goes bust. So we have seen some challenges from working with administrators and how the legislation around administrators and the supply licence regime works. You know, it can cause some issues within the industry. So again, some additional powers there. and additional powers as well to strengthen our licensing revocation ability. So, you know, rather than a long process, making it easier for us to take a supply license away where we feel that there's an unsustainable business model, where we feel a company is getting into difficulty, or they're just not acting in the best interest of consumers. If we have those powers, which are, you know, pretty significant changes, I think that would really, really help us perform our role as regulator.
And the prepayment legislation, a legal obligation to replace prepayment?
It's an interesting question. I'd have to take that away, do some analysis on it, and think about the benefits benefits for that. What I said earlier rings true, that some consumers really like the prepayment method. They use and choose that prepayment method. So we have to be very, very careful in assuming that taking that away or changing it in some way would have a benefit for consumers.
Requested by the consumer, a legal obligation to replace it would hardly be revolutionary, but would be very practical.
Yes, it would, but also we also need to bear in mind and be balanced that if there's a debt on a meter, often a prepayment is the best solution to enable that debt to be recovered. And if that is enabling the industry to work as a whole, then maybe that's the right way forward. We're getting into a debate of policy here.
Maybe in an energy price crisis, the balance needs to shift from the companies to the consumers in this instance. But I'll leave that one there, but you can come back to me. I think you've said you would. And I just wanted to finally ask Neil Kenward, as Brexit proceeds and the GB and the EU energy markets remain closely aligned, I don't know if you heard President Macron's speech, but he's obviously looking at a potential of a wider alignment of non-EU countries, but European countries, particularly for defence and energy issues. But we heard from Scottish Power, from the supplier, that they thought there was sufficient domestic energy market reform could take place to deliver what you've been talking about without wider EU reform. But I suspect there will be both EU and GB, wider reform of energy markets. So what do you see as the challenges and opportunities in the short term, but also strategically going forward?
Yeah, so I think obviously we have to prioritise getting the GB market working as effectively as possible for that new net zero world. The critical link for us, as you'll appreciate, with the European markets is through the interconnectors. And as we move to this more renewable-dominated electricity system, the importance of interconnectors will become ever greater so that we can export. So we were talking about exporting Scottish surplus renewables to England, but actually the whole of GB will have surplus renewables in the future on windy and sunny days. And actually that the interconnectors will enable us, the GB system, to export those surpluses and maintain a more stable, low-cost system. And then when we need power in, when we haven't got as much of that wind and solar power generating, we can bring that power in from those interconnected zones. And of course, now that includes Norway, which is a great addition to the network, because they have a separate system. They have a very hydro-dominated system. It's a very low-cost system. And so the sort of things we might be able to see in future is when there's a surplus of power in GB or in Scotland, that can be exported along the pipes to Norway. They use it to use pumped hydro, so they put water up in their dams, and then when we need the power back in GB, they let it go and send the hydropower back to us. So it's a really effective way to integrate the markets, and I think in Ofgem we're really keen to make sure that there is this pipeline of further interconnector projects, that they continue to be developed, because we think that's really strongly in the interests of GB consumers as we move to this new net zero world.
And that's infrastructure, and obviously we've got our own Cruachan Dam here in terms of pumped storage, which does a similar function.
Right.
But in terms of market reform, could you confirm that we don't necessarily need to see reforms in the EU market where we're aligned still to possibly about 2026, we can do sufficient within our own domestic market to meet the needs of what the UK as a,
that's
as
right.
an energy
and,
market
and needs. So the primary determinant for the effective operating of GB market must obviously be those GB reforms, and then we will respond and through interconnectors and other mechanisms try and make sure that we have the most efficient connections with the other bits of the market, which of course includes Ireland as well as continental Europe.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. Thank you both for being with us this morning and giving evidence to the committee. Very much appreciated. The committee will continue its scrutiny tomorrow when we hear from Greg Hands, MP, Minister of State at the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy. And next week, our final evidence session for this inquiry will be with the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport. Thank you to members and thank you to our guests this morning. That brings us to the end of the public part of the meeting. Thank you.